Hi friends, we're coming to you today from Northampton, Massachusetts. We're on a little weekend getaway from home, and we did a little local bookstore tour. We actually drove around to three local independently owned bookstores today, so we're going to take you on that little tour, and we're also going to show you what we picked up along the way. So our first stop was Gray Matter Books in Hadley, Mass. And we know Gray Matter because there's a second shop in New Haven, Connecticut, near where we live. But the Hadley store is the first one, the one that's been around for a long time. The tagline is the hard-to-find bookstore for hard-to-find books. And I would say that the hard-to-find part was pretty accurate,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
There was signage off the main highway, I guess, but...
Yeah.
It was...
It wasn't that hard to find. There was a couple of turns. The GPS did a great job.
It was in an unexpected place, though, because you turn
okay.
down this kind of like dirt gravel driveway, and you're like, am I in the right place? And then you drive back into the parking lot, and you have to kind of poke around to find it. It's just a very unassuming little exterior, but when you get inside, it's one of those awesome bookstores that's just packed. Mm-hmm. It's like a rabbit warren in there.
It's a little bit like the Harry Potter tent that just keeps going and going and going.
It's just one of those, you know, anybody who loves bookstores knows how much fun that is to go into a bookstore where, you know, the bookcases are all set, you know, there's corners to go around and suddenly there's another room where you didn't expect one. So these are all used books, and the owner, Sam Burton, is really a great book buyer because he knows what he's looking for. So he's not just trying to fill the space. He's very particular about what he's looking for. So I noticed, for example, that the photography section was excellent. He had books about all of the women photographers that I'm really kind of interested in from a writing project I've done in the past. And we went through the kids section.
Uh-huh.
And
but the kids section is right next to the cooking section. Why? Because.
And I mean, the kids section had like all the usual, you know, classic hardcover picture books that you might expect. And I was actually like, the top of the bookshelf where the kids' stuff was really precarious. I was afraid I was gonna knock the whole thing over. But he also had some old Raggedy Ann books that, I don't know, I didn't check the copyright, but I would guess they're probably from the 1930s.
Mm-hmm.
And definitely some first editions of some classic kids' books.
The music section was really good. The classical music writing in there is fabulous. And the rock and roll section is really well curated as well.
I mean, you know, there's so much there. Like, we're not even scratching the surface. But the fun thing I want to mention that happened while we were there was that I asked for the biography section, and they said, oh, we don't have a biography section. All the biographies are mixed in depending on who you're looking for. And, like, I mean, obviously the authors are in. If you're looking for a fiction author's biography, their biography will be next to their fiction books. And if you're looking for a politician, it'll be in the, you know, political science section. I was looking for the biography, and have been for a while, looking for the biography of Sylvia Beach. I mentioned it in an earlier video. She was the owner of Shakespeare and Company, which is a very famous bookstore in Paris in the 1930s. And late 20s, I guess, into the early 40s. You know, I wasn't like, I could have bought it online, but I thought, oh, one of these days it'll show up. So I asked the owner, I just said, yeah, I'm looking for this Sylvia Beach biography. And he just walked like right over to the corner and just pulled it off the shelf. And sure enough, it was the one I was looking for. Sylvia Beach and the Lost Generation, A History of Literary Paris in the 20s and 30s. So I'm really excited to read this biography. It's been on my mind for a while, ever since I read her autobiography, which was really fun, but I could tell that there were gaps in the story that she was telling, and we actually talked a little bit about that today. So I think the biography is maybe going to fill in some of those gaps of things that I thought might be interesting to learn about Sylvia Beach. So that was one of my finds at Gray Matter. These are used books. Actually, I don't think you picked anything up there. I think the other two from Gray Matter are mine as well.
I picked up a lot of things. I just didn't buy anything.
So I also got two books from the travel section. Not books about, like, traveling yourself, but what would you call it? Like, travel journals, travel writing.
Memoir.
And so one of them is a book, again, it's been on my to read list. But this is called The Places in Between by Rory Stewart. It's a book about a walking tour of Afghanistan. It says in January 2002, Rory Stewart walked across Afghanistan, surviving by his wits, his knowledge of Persian dialects and Muslim customs, and the kindness of strangers. And I'm really interested in this because we have some friends from Afghanistan, and so I've been reading quite a bit about Afghanistan, and I think this looks really interesting. And then the other book that I picked up that was very close to that one on the shelf is Shadow of the Silk Road by Colin Thubron, I'm not sure how to pronounce that. And so the Silk Road also I think is just kind of interesting. I don't really know very much about it, but I'm interested to learn. To travel the Silk Road, the greatest land route on earth, is to trace the passage not only of trade and armies, but also of ideas, religions, and invention. This also looks really interesting to me. So I obviously was lingering in the travel section for a while. I didn't have to linger looking for this. I just had to ask, and it just came flying off the shelf. Where else were you looking? Music?
Cookbook section.
Cookbooks.
And that was an interesting section because there were some things. LaRousse was in there and some very traditional things. But then every now and then there would just be a pop-out unusual book that was really great to just kind of just enjoy the feel and the richness of it, of an offbeat book.
And then as we were wandering through, we saw a set of Thoreau's writings,
right,
a full set. NPR was on the radio the whole time we were there, which actually I found really kind of distracting.
Right, but I found that book on Puritan poetry.
Puritan.
And there was this great section about Edward Taylor and his biography.
Oh yeah, there was a whole Jonathan Edwards section.
Right.
Yeah.
So. Right.
Anyway, Gray Matter is a fabulous bookshop if you're ever in the vicinity of Hadley, Mass., or you can come check it out in New Haven, Connecticut. It's a smaller shop. I think it says on the website that there are 40,000 books in Hadley, and the New Haven shop is only about a third the size, but the New Haven store is right in downtown New Haven, basically adjacent to the Yale University campus. Okay, our second stop then was Amherst Books, right in downtown Amherst, Mass. This bookshop had on the main level, when you walk in, it was all new, and then downstairs, all used. So it was a mix of new and used. And our friend Mark told us that we should go there, and we realized why pretty quickly.
There's a beautiful poetry section in this bookstore. It has great span to it, but so many individual authors in there. It's a poetry section where you could really just get lost for hours, I think.
Yeah. It also, I mean, they say they also specialize in literature and philosophy. I noticed they had quite a few graphic novels. They had some, they say they also carry a lot of small press titles. They had quite a few literary journals. Mm-hmm. And then downstairs, there was a pretty good selection, I would say, downstairs. Mm-hmm. Brand new things that hadn't been shelved yet. You could still wander down the aisle downstairs and see what was new that just hadn't quite been put in the right place yet. So that was kind of nice.
Yeah, and the books in that section, sort of like Gray Matter, what's coming into that shop has obviously been selected carefully. That in the unshelved section, there was just really high quality stuff.
Yeah.
It wasn't just pulp toss outs.
Yeah, somebody's really taking care with deciding what belongs downstairs and upstairs.
Yeah. One of the things I liked about upstairs is they had probably four or five tables of selected books. So, you know, like I love going to the store and they'll have staff picks, always a great place to go. But then they also had like Can't Get Enough Bridgerton, and there were other, there was a section of books that are sort of thematically or chronologically related to that series. So they've really done some really thoughtful things about sort of picking collections and helping you sort through. I always feel overwhelmed in bookstores because there's just so much amazing stuff and I need someone to kind of make some choices and suggestions. And they did a really good job with that.
So you want to talk about what you picked up there?
Sure. I love the best of collections because the writing in here is really fabulous. And so for instance, like the best food writing is always inspirational. I love to cook, so there's that angle to it. But the way people are writing about food and the whole industry is really exciting. Food writing didn't really used to be considered a legitimate genre in the past 10, 15 years. It's really come into its own. And so being able to see what is being published in Houston and what's being mm-hmm. published in San Francisco and whatnot is always interesting. And then I picked up the mysteries book. I don't read a lot of mysteries, mm-hmm. but every time I pick up this book and read through it, I am just rocked by the storytelling in here. And, you know, short stories, I think, often get sort of pushed aside for novels, mm-hmm. But the mysteries are usually just so well written and so engaging. So it makes for just special reading.
And then at Amherst, I picked up, so I guess we were both kind of browsing at that point in sections that we, or things that we don't normally read, because I picked up A People's Future of the United States, which is speculative fiction from 25 extraordinary writers. So speculative fiction, which is sometimes a term used interchangeably with science fiction, is something that I've been thinking about a lot and writing a little bit about, but or a genre that I've been kind of dipping my toe into, but I really don't know very much about it. So this looked like a collection that would maybe help me see what other people are doing in that genre, and it just looked really interesting. It's edited by Victor LaValle and John Joseph Adams, and they invited all of these writers to share, it says, to share stories that explore new forms of freedom, love, and justice. They asked for narratives that would challenge oppressive American myths, release us from the chokehold of our history, and give us new futures to believe in. So that was a new book from the new section at Amherst Books. And then I picked this up in the downstairs in the used book section. We got some books. We got some bookmarks. This one is about creative nonfiction. So I'm also thinking about writing more in that genre. And so this is just about writing creative nonfiction. And then also I think the second half of the book is some creative nonfiction pieces. This was published by AWP, which is now called the Association of Writers and Writing Programs. So I'm looking forward to thinking more about creative nonfiction as well. And I actually have a video on creative nonfiction, so if you're interested in learning more about what it is, you can check that out. Okay, and finally, our third stop was Broadside Bookshop, which is right in downtown Northampton, Mass. According to the website, it was opened in 1974, so it's been there on Main Street in Northampton for a really long time now. It was the smallest bookstore that we went to today. Packed pretty full, though, of great stuff. And it was also all new. I didn't see any used books there. And I would say that also that's one of those bookstores that's, like, they had some gifty kind of stuff mm-hmm. in the center of the store. Like, I don't know, what did you see?
Yeah, there were some sort of clever cards, but they're also, you know, sort of reader's aids. I mean, highlighters, things to hold your books open, you know, so relevant stuff.
Yeah, right. And puzzles, they had a lot of puzzles.
Oh yeah, that looked like a good section.
Yeah. By then, it was our third stop, so you can see we only picked up one book there. and it was also getting close to closing time, and so we didn't have as much time to browse there maybe as we would have liked. You want to talk about what we picked up there?
So this is the Appalachian Mountain Club book about hikes in central Massachusetts. We also looked at their book on hikes in the Berkshires.
Yep.
A little farther west. But this is a great little collection of hikes sort of in the Connecticut River Valley part of Massachusetts. It's an area that I think often goes overlooked but is accessible from so many areas. So we
because
thought
Route 91 runs right straight up through
right,
the
or
center
the Mass
of Massachusetts.
Pike could,
and the Mass Pike crosses right? over there, yeah.
And so so this is sort of an access point for us to this area that's accessible but often overlooked. And this just looked like it had really great directions in it, estimated times, things like that that'll make hikes sort of predictable and successful.
So it occurs to me that we didn't really buy any novels today.
No.
That's kind of surprising. Okay, so last week we took a day trip to New York City and we went to the Strand bookstore. So we'll throw this in as a bonus. We don't have our Strand books with us. But anyway, we each bought two books, I think, at the Strand. So the Strand is this massive bookstore in New York City. It's down on Lower Broadway, and it's how many floors? Four floors, I think. And it's got used books in the basement, and then new, I don't know, were the new and used mixed in together? Actually, there were used books on the first floor, too. Anyway, it's another one of those bookstores that's just packed full of amazing selections. Mm-hmm. It's actually where I picked up the Sylvia Beach autobiography that got me started on another trip that we had taken down there. But anyway, we just kind of ran down there and went shopping on Monday last week. So I picked up a collection of stories, I guess, by a Polish writer whose name I can't even tell you. I'll stick it in the comments below. But a Pulitzer Prize winning book that I wasn't aware of. So I picked that up, and then I also picked up a book about writing science fiction that... Mm-hmm. So you can see I'm kind of on a science speculative fiction kick right now.
Right. Well, I picked up David Byrne's How Music Works. And I've read a couple of his other books about things like bicycling. And his mind is just so interesting in sort of how it moves in and out of topic. So I'm really curious to see what he does with something like this that's so integral to who he is. But we also picked up Vanity Fair.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so when we were in Broadside Books today, on the staff picks shelves, Infinite Jest was sitting there. You may know if you've been following our videos that we are working our way through Infinite Jest and posting a video every 100 pages. And so we both saw that and thought, but we're more than halfway through now. Yep. So then we started talking about what are we going to read next? And Thackeray's Vanity Fair came up. So Brad picked up a copy of Vanity Fair because we each have to have our own copy if we're going to do this. Mm-hmm. It would be really hard to share.
Right. And it's one of those books that we do have a copy at home already.
We have
already.
One at home.
I don't know where it came from.
I think we determined that I took it from a high school I used to teach at, but I'm going to say that I took it because they weren't teaching it anymore. I'm going to say I took it legitimately.
Mm-hmm. But it was one of those just awesome, great books that's been sitting on our shelves because at some point someone said, oh, I want to read that.
Yeah, and right? we've never read it. How many books do you think we have on the shelf at home that we have every intention of reading someday? Like, what percentage of the books that we have at home do you think are books that we haven't even read yet?
I try to live by read a book I already have before I buy a book. So you'll notice the difference in the stack over here.
I bought more than you did today.
You did. But on the other hand, there are some books that you should just have.
Yeah, so I'm going to say, like, tell me if this sounds wrong to you.
Right, I dodged this question.
I'm going to say that at least 40% of our books we haven't even read. Maybe
that might be
a little bit high. 30%.
Yeah.
A lot of them we just haven't read. Mm-hmm. And I mean, we obviously have a lot of books that we read. We were both English majors, so we have a lot of books that we read in college and high school. And then the dirty little secret of English teachers is that we read the same books over and over and over in order to teach them. I'm also going to be doing a video about that soon, I think, because it is a dirty little secret. Like, English teachers should be always reading what's new and keeping current, and it's just not possible because you have to go back, and even if you don't have to reread, like, I certainly don't reread something cover to cover, but you do have to review it in order to teach it. So that's another whole conversation. We'll have that another time. But that's our tour of Central Massachusetts bookshops that we took today. If you like what you see here, please subscribe and please support your local independent bookstores. And I'll be back soon with another episode of Better Book Clubs.